welcome to my show. Really excited today because for the first time I am having the Mystic Aquarium here. Kelly is here to join me. Kelly, just introduce yourself and tell me what you do, your title and what you do.
Wonderful, absolutely. Well, first, thanks so much for having me. I'm really excited to be here to talk about the excitement of Mystic Aquarium. But so yeah, my name is Kelly Mattis, and officially I am the Vice President of Education and Conservation for Sea Research Foundation and Mystic Aquarium. So that means actually a lot of things, and I'll tell you, one thing about working for the aquarium is no day is ever the same. So I never quite know what I'm going to be doing on any given day, but the education department has just a wealth of programs and opportunities and fun things to offer for the entire community. So we're really excited to come and talk
now,
about it today.
Are some of these props that you brought, are these all things that you have at the aquarium and that you teach on, or...
Well, I thought I'd dress things up a little.
Okay.
So I did strategically pick what animals that I would bring today. But yeah, I brought our seal. We can talk a little bit about our seal rescue program.
That's exciting.
You
haven't had that the entire time that you've been open. Is that, how old
yeah,
is that?
Yeah, we actually started in 1975.
So it's been a long time
that
you've had that, because it's kind of exciting when I look through and see these seals. Now, how do they come to you, these seals?
Well, we've had a lot of high profile, let's call them, cases lately. So that may be why you've been hearing a little bit more about it. But basically the mission of the Seal Rescue Clinic, or the Animal Rescue Program, is to rescue, rehabilitate, and release. So whenever an animal comes up, they're primarily seals within our stranding region. We have a crew of actually 300 first responders, we call them.
Oh, really?
Scattered all over the area, and they will go out and we'll get a call, and those first responders will go out and check on the health of the animal.
It works that somebody sees a sick seal?
Yeah.
So the public, what should the public do? How would you even know to worry about a seal, first of
all? Absolutely. Well, and that's a really good point, because seals naturally come up on the coastline. Not every seal that you see laying on the beach is sick. They naturally will come up and they'll sunbathe and they'll relax a little before going back swimming. So that's where this real team of first responders comes in, that obviously our staff can't get to the far reaches of every animal that's called in. So anybody can call if they see a seal. They call the regular aquarium number, and they will report that they see a seal and anything that they particularly notice about it, but we never want the public to get close to the animal.
Because I heard that they can be nasty and bite you. So you don't necessarily have to call if you see a seal, just if you're concerned.
Yeah,
I think there's something about it that makes you concerned. Like what would concern you?
Well, I mean,
they kind of just lay there and don't do much,
so
I don't know whether I wouldn't know when to be concerned, put it that way.
And I would say most of the time you can tell if, you know, a seal is sick, if it looks particularly thin, if it's lethargic, if it's not responding at all, if it looks like, you know, something may have happened to it, if it's out of the water for more than 24 hours in the same spot.
Okay.
That can sometimes be another telling factor.
Because I've only gone seal watching once. Like, I've never just happened upon a seal.
Yeah.
It was when I went with Project Oceanology.
Yeah.
And we saw all these seals off Fisher's Island. In the winter, it was freezing.
Yes, and they do love it. We usually see them between about January and the end of the summer is primarily when we see most of the seals in our area.
And they were all doing that banana pose, you know, where they're trying to keep their tail and heads out of the water.
Yep.
But honestly, I thought they were going to do tricks or do something cool.
So
I was mildly disappointed. So I realized, okay, that's the sea lions that do cool stuff.
Yes, it's a lot of hanging out and swimming and staying on the beach. But
And you have a sea lion show.
We
for people
do.
Who want a little bit more than looking at them laying on. I enjoyed it very much.
Yeah.
You know, 'cause like the cold spray, and thankfully I dressed appropriately.
Yeah.
But you know, but my jeans were wet and freezing onto my body.
Yeah.
You know, I shouldn't have worn those. But I did enjoy it, but I actually enjoy the sea lion show a little better.
Yeah, and we have, for anybody who hasn't been to Mystic Aquarium lately, we do have a brand new sea lion show.
Oh, you
started
do?
In the beginning of the summer.
Oh.
And it's a lot of fun. It's a totally different kind of theme. It's about the marine animal security team. It's a lot of fun and a good time. So if you haven't seen that new sea lion show, definitely come by.
I want to go see it, and I can't wait, because this Friday is your last for the season, Cocktails with Whales.
That's true.
And my husband and I have always loved going. inclined to that.
So. Well, it's perfect. You get to relax. The summer's been beautiful.
Yeah, and the music. I enjoy the music because you never let really loud bands play there, or else you make them turn it down or something.
Well, the glass with the water, you know, we are pretty careful of that.
Yeah, but I appreciate it because I feel stressed, like the fish, I feel stressed when the music's too loud and I can't talk to my husband and my friends.
Yep.
To me, that's the whole point of going out.
Yep.
So the first time I went was a couple summers ago, and I just love that I got to really see the beluga whales up close.
Yep.
And a friend of mine has a guide dog, and the dog was fascinated with the beluga whale, but then the beluga whale caught sight of the dog and came up to the glass, and the dog was really afraid. Because she's used to negotiating around everything, but not around a whale.
Yep.
So she didn't know what to think of that. They are so social.
Yeah, they're really interactive, and especially in those cocktails with the whales kind of situations.
They are.
Where it's maybe getting a little bit dark, they're not used to having people around. You know, it really is enriching for them to have different kinds of experiences and see different things.
It's a lot of fun. So I love filming them when they're really just watching all of us. And sometimes they look like they're trying to, like, not bite us necessarily, but doing something. I don't know what they want to do.
They're all just expressions. You know, we all make different expressions and they all do different things, but each whale is very much an individual, just like every person
really?
Is an individual.
Do you know any of them? Or
You definitely get to know their personalities. And we have one, our youngest whale, Juno, is the one that tends to interact the most with people.
Oh, really?
And seems, you know, very curious. And he's the one, if you saw a couple years ago, there was the mariachi band. And there was a video of a mariachi band played, and it looked like, you know, the beluga was dancing behind
them.
So he's definitely very interactive and very social.
Now I see pictures where people are getting married in front of them. Is that something that happens there?
You can have your complete wedding at Mystic Aquarium. So people get married right in front of the beluga whale exhibit and then have their full dinner and refreshments and everything inside in our main gallery.
Oh,
and it's, I mean, it's absolutely beautiful. It's a stunning place to be able to have that kind of event. And I don't know if you've ever been, but Ocean Commotion.
No, I don't even know what that is.
So that's our Black Tie fundraiser that we do every year. Mm-hmm. It's on September 20th this year. And, you know, the aquarium just dresses up so incredibly well that it makes all those kinds of events, you know, a lot of fun. And I think it's different than being in like a ballroom. You know, you can really come. It gives the people something to talk about and something to interact with. So it's a beautiful, Mystic Aquarium is a beautiful place for all kinds of events.
Yeah, I even went to Cocktails with Whales once when it rained, so it couldn't be held outside. And actually, I thought that was really fun because it was beautiful in there at night.
Yeah.
And like I said, the band kept the music low, so I could still talk to everybody at the table and just had a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Now, you got voted in a USA Today poll. You were voted one of the 10 best aquariums in the country.
Yeah.
That's pretty exciting. When did that happen? Do you know?
It really was an honor, you know, to be nominated there, and a lot of people voted for us, which was a lot of fun. But, you know, we really have a lot of world-class programs and opportunities at the aquarium, you know, that's right here in people's backyards in southeastern Connecticut.
Is there any program you want to talk about that, you know, that I don't know what goes on for the children. Is there something particular you want to say?
Sure.
Well, I wouldn't know.
I think, you know, right now it's we're segueing from summer to fall. Mm-hmm. You know, we're going from our summer camp season. We do 9 weeks of summer camp, and the children have all kinds of different opportunities. A lot of people don't know about, you know, some of the programs we do, which is why we appreciate being able to come onto this show. But now that we're segueing into fall, we're getting ready for school programs. And I think one of the most exciting things that a lot of people don't know about is we actually host a licensed preschool at the aquarium.
Oh, you do?
We do. So you can come between 3 and 5 years old, just like a regular preschool, 2 days a week. And there are 3 different sessions, and children can have their preschool at the aquarium.
Wow.
So it's...
You have to be out of your diapers, right? Is that one of their requirements?
Yeah, it's not an absolute requirement. We're willing to work with people, but they, you know, they just have such unique opportunities. They get to go out, and there's a beluga day, and they get to stand at the glass of the beluga whales and meet a beluga. They might have a fully dressed scuba diver come walking into the classroom. The penguins come to visit. It's just such a great environment for learning, because you never know what's going to happen, and we really use all the opportunities that exist at the aquarium. So that's a lot of fun.
Right. Now, what do you do? Have I read, is it true? Do you have sleepovers there sometimes?
We do.
Oh my gosh.
We have overnights at the aquarium where we have them both for scouts and families, and people come, and we have all kinds of different activities during the evening. You might do a squid dissection. You might do an outdoor tour, which means you get to walk around and see all the animals after we close, which is a lot of fun. Because if you probably haven't been at Cocktails of the Whales after dark, but the belugas in the exhibit, you know, they look just like they're floating white masses in a dark ocean. And to see all the seals and sea lions out of the water, resting and on the rocks. So it's a totally different experience to see the animals after dark. So, and then you sleep right on the main gallery.
But what time is there lights out? Or what time do you go to sleep?
Usually, depending on the program, sometime around 10, 10:30 is usually the lights out time. Again, depending on the program. But, you know, you get the opportunity to sleep and wake up to a coral reef or the sea lions playing or the octopus or the fishes.
Did you ever have, like, for grown-ups, a grown-up sleepover?
We haven't had one specifically just for grown-ups, but we do see family units and scout groups come, and they bring, you know, we often have a one-to-one ratio where an adult will come with every child.
Okay, so just I need to have that unique have a child or something
no?
so I can come.
No, you could still come to a family overnight. You're welcome. Anybody's welcome. But it's but generally the activities are gauged for, like, you know, 5 to 12-year-olds is generally what we gauge the activities for. But it's just such a unique experience to be able to sleep among the fishes, I guess.
It'd be fun, like, for the next time we're out of power for a week.
we did
come sleep there instead of our own cold home.
You know, we did offer that last, I think it was it 2 years ago? Last year,
did
2 years
really?
Ago, when it was just, we offered, because so much of our staff was out of power, and obviously everything at the aquarium, because of all the pump systems and the aeration and everything that needs to happen with the exhibits, everything is on generator.
Yeah.
So we can run our entire facility. So we did offer it up if any of our staff or volunteers needed a place that we would, that
oh,
we
so
would
I
host them
become
there.
A volunteer then if I want to sleep there.
Well, you know, we spend a lot of time there, so the idea of also pulling an all-nighter isn't always, but it's just, again, it's just such a unique opportunity. And that's what we try to offer, is the most unique experiences that we can.
Well, it sounds like a lot of fun. What is this?
You said
you were willing to put this on your head, and I'm going to hold you to it.
I absolutely will. So this is part of our preschool curriculum. So obviously we use all the different animals and people, experts that we have at the aquarium. We also have these kind of programs for schools. Mm-hmm. So we go out within 75 miles. We actually have, we call them penguin mobiles. There's big penguins on the side of our vehicles, but we'll drive them within 75 miles of the aquarium and bring an aquarium experience to you. Mm-hmm. So I did say I would put this on, and I will be honored to that. So this is a class we call House for Hermit Crab. Mm-hmm. And basically what we do is we always try to have a literacy component, and we read this book, House for Hermit Crab, which is about the different, it's about a hermit crab, and he finds a new shell and how he has to decorate it. So we have a child who puts on this entire hermit crab costume, and it basically turns them into a hermit crab so that they can learn. You like that?
Yes, thank you.
How do I look? How do I look? I'm very tall. You like it?
Yes, I do.
So the child will put on all the different aspects, you know, again, to reinforce the learning and the understanding of the hermit crab. They'll put on the hermit crab shell. Mm-hmm. They'll attach all the different animals they read about in the story right to the shell. So the hermit crab can decorate its shell, and then obviously, now these little parts don't fit me. I won't pretend to put them on. But we also talk all about the different parts of the hermit crab. So the claws and what they're for, how the legs help to hook them into the shell, so that the kids really do get to become a hermit crab.
Oh, great.
And learn all about the different adaptations of the animals. So it's just a great way to reinforce learning. And then we usually also bring live animals with us. So we travel with a cooler full of invertebrates, lobsters, horseshoe crabs, snails, hermit crabs, all kinds of things, so that we can put those out. The kids can get their hands wet.
Do the crabs bite you? I mean, do they all have pinchers that pinch?
Yeah, they have. Darf, darf, darf.
So it
they
hurts,
do. They
right?
No, they do have claws. I mean, if some of the lobsters, we do have rubber bands around the lobster's claws.
Okay.
But we make sure to teach the kids and everybody who's participating the right way to hold the animals. If you hold them by the shell, you know, they can't reach their little claws around to get you. So so there's obviously a important way to hold them, and also it's important to be respectful of the animals. Mm-hmm. So we teach the kids involved in the programs that.
Now,
I'm going to take the hat off now.
Okay. Now, what do you do? Are you involved with the Titanic exhibit at all?
Yeah, so we teach about all kinds of things within the education department. So that's definitely one of them, is about ocean exploration.
And you're teaching that to who? Middle school? I mean, I wasn't sure.
Yeah, well, our ocean exploration camps, we find, you know, 9 to 12 in middle school. 9 to 12 years old in middle school is really a time when kids tend to be fascinated in that subject. So we have camps about ocean exploration, we have formal school programs about ocean exploration, and then, you know, on things like overnights, we rotate in different classes. So that may be a class for a certain year, but it's such a dynamic and interactive exhibit and such a unique use of technology that we definitely try to integrate, you know, the topic as much as we can.
Do you have a special part of the exhibit that you particularly like to look at and think about? Just on your own, you know, you're not having to teach anybody anything. It's just you with the exhibit.
You know, what I will tell you is part of the exhibit, there is a big wall and it has fish, obviously digital fish, swimming through it. And people just walk by it. But if you walk up to that wall, the wall actually interacts with you. And many people do not know that.
In the Titanic exhibit?
In the Titanic exhibit.
I don't remember it.
Yep, right when you come out of when you go down a little bit through through the darker passageway and you come out, there's a big wall right in front of you. And if you walk up to it, one of the fish actually comes right over to you and then he will follow you wherever you walk back and forth.
I have to try that.
Wall.
Okay, you just given me a secret that I did not know.
A lot of people don't know. It's one of those, you know, you really have to interact with the exhibit to learn all the special little characteristics about it. And I think that's what really makes it very interesting and such a unique point of view coming from Dr. Ballard himself. So,
well, my favorite is the shoes, recreation of the shoes he found at the bottom.
Yep.
Because I heard him give a talk. My husband's a member, so we were invited to a talk that he gave, and we were sitting in that little auditorium.
Yep.
And somebody asked him what struck you the most when you first discovered the Titanic, and he said the shoes, because that is what's all that's left of the people. And so I went back out and looked at the shoes, and it made me think of a New York Times article I read from that period, talking about 30,000 people went down to the pier to see the survivors. And New York Times is reporting how one of the first people off is a woman. She had just gotten married and she fainted in her father's arms. And I always wondered what happened to her husband. Mm-hmm. And apparently his body had never been found. Mm-hmm. So I wondered, could one of those pairs of shoes be his? Mm-hmm. And he didn't know, she might not have known it, but he insisted that she get on the lifeboat, and she didn't want to go, of course. But she went on, and she was just pregnant, so she gave birth about 8 months later.
Wow! And that's
so I think maybe those are his. And I gave you a copy of my book, Mystic Seafarer's Trail, and I do talk about that because the shoes just brought up all these thoughts about whose they really are. And because, like I said, many bodies were not found, or some were found and they were never identified. Yeah. So it wouldn't have been them, but I just thought that was interesting.
Well, and it's such an important human interest story, and so many people are so interested in it because of all those mysteries and what happened to all the people and all of those stories about different families and the different experiences that happened. So I think that's why it resonates, you know, more than 100 years later now.
Right. That's horrible. Yeah, because now when I look at ships, I look at their lifeboats and I never see enough, but they must have them hidden somewhere.
I'm pretty sure that they've got you more than well covered, but it certainly thinks, I mean, and that was one of the most important things that came out of Titanic, was that real laws were put into place to make sure that it never happened again. And so, you know, with every tragedy, you have to make sure that you learn something from it and make sure that better comes of it.
Right.
And I think that's really important, and that definitely did happen after Titanic sunk.
Yeah, like I thought that was interesting that the U.S. Coast Guard now looks for icebergs, and I think they're based out of Groton, I think the Avery campus. I don't know if I have that right or not. But that was instituted after that.
Ice Patrol,
So the Ice Patrol. So I thought that was interesting.
Yeah.
Do you think that exhibit will be there a long time, the Titanic exhibit?
Well, I would anticipate it'll be there a little longer. It's already been there a couple years. So we're constantly trying to provide new things for our audiences and new things to come and see. So it's definitely there for a while, and then we'll We'll see how the future brings Mystic Aquarium, but that's what makes it exciting, is right. New things are coming all the time.
Now, I didn't know you had alligators until you brought your stuffed animal alligator. Have I not seen them?
Well, the alligators are part of our interactive scales and tails exhibit. Mm-hmm. So we have a lot of, we call ourselves New England's hands-on aquarium because we have so many interactive experiences that you can have, and the alligators are one of them. So we have,
I could wrestle an alligator if I wanted to?
Well, it wouldn't be much of a wrestling match. They're about this big, maybe a little longer now. So you could, but it'd be awkward. But you can come, and our interpreters will present the animal for you, and you can see what it feels like. And again, we really feel like having these more intimate hands-on experiences with animals really brings people closer to them and closer to the natural world, because that's what we aim to do, is help protect and promote awareness of the ocean planet. So mm-hmm. that's what we're trying to do through everything.
So what happens when the alligator gets bigger?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they are from an alligator farm in St. Augustine, Florida. Mm-hmm. We are accredited by an organization called the Association of Zoos and Aquariums, mm-hmm. which means that all of our standards are top-notch, and they are as well. So we actually get baby alligators from them. When they get too big for our exhibit standpoint, we send them back to St. Augustine, where they have a huge alligator farm, and they then will give them to places who have large enclosures and are looking for larger animals. So it's a very interesting
exchange
program.
So it's not like they grow up and then you're still being allowed to touch them.
No, we don't. I don't think our interpreters would be very excited if they were like 6-foot alligators. But
so the sea lions, do you get to watch them train them? I mean, that must be a lot of work to train.
It is.
I mean, it looks easy when I'm watching it, but I know. It must have taken a lot of hours to get those sea lions to touch the right number or jump. Don't you have one that's kind of fat and lazy and sometimes doesn't do everything?
Oh,
well, no offense, but he's kind of funny.
Every animal is an individual, and we love them all equally. But again, every animal, you're right in that they all have totally different personalities. We have some younger ones, we have some older ones, we have some ones that tend to like to do certain things. But it does. They're incredibly intelligent animals, and that's really what we want to show. Case, and show off some of the behaviors that these animals are able to do, and it makes it a lot of fun. It is a lot of work, of course, but it makes it a lot of fun.
Because I laugh when there's this one that wouldn't do half the stuff, and I couldn't tell if that was part of the act to make us laugh.
Yep.
Or if it wasn't part of the act, and the hope was that he was going to do what the other two did.
Yeah.
But they did such a good job of making me laugh that I thought, well, maybe that was part of the act, that he was going to be stubborn and not do it.
Probably not, unfortunately for the sea lion staff, but that's what they do. I mean, when you work with live animals, you have to be able, it's like working with kids. You have to be able to think on your feet and just move to something new.
And make it fun. Make it fun that he didn't do his trick.
Yeah. And I'll tell you something else really fun that we have coming up is, have you heard of the run walk for the penguins?
I read it, I didn't pay attention.
Okay, so October 18th, we have our run walk for the penguins. And they, as part of that, it's a whole day of events. If you participate in the run walk, you get to come into the aquarium, and they will often actually have penguin races up in our marine theater. But it's a 5K run or a 2-mile walk, and the money raised goes to our penguin conservation efforts.
Okay.
And they often have, thinking of unique things, they often have penguins at the finish line. So as you're crossing the race, looking beautiful, I'm sure, from your 5-mile run, they have the penguins there. Some people come and dress, you thought my hermit crab was funny, dress and run the entire race in a penguin costume. So that's another fun thing that that you can do at the aquarium, and also help with our penguin conservation efforts, both here and in South Africa itself.
Where do you conserve penguins here? I mean, I thought they weren't out in the wild.
Well, they're not in Connecticut, obviously, but all penguins live south of the equator.
Okay.
So we have, obviously, a colony of penguins in our exhibit at Mystic Aquarium, as do a fair number of places in North America. But we have a partnership with an organization called SANCOB, which does direct penguin rehabilitation in South Africa. So they do there what we do with our seals here. They actually bring them into their center and rehabilitate them. So we have staff members who actually travel from Mystic Aquarium down to SANCOB. Because they have the incredible knowledge of the penguins already from working with our animals, they know how to properly care for them, they know what they need as far as medical treatment, they know how to hold them, how to help them. So everything that we can learn within our aquarium, we can help also with wild populations.
Now, did you ever notice a painting that it's they sang it takes place in the North Pole and you see a penguin. Do you ever see that?
Yes, it's it didn't happen, folks. I got news. A penguin and a polar bear have never met.
Right, so that's why I laugh now, because yeah. I love to read Arctic adventures, yep. like Shackleton's Adventure yep. and Admiral Byrd. And so I do kind of know that about polar bears yep. and penguins. So I laugh when I see a painting.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, they didn't do their homework.
I know. But, you know, we'll let the media have their fair amount of artistry. But, no, it would never happen. All penguins live. The furthest north is the Galapagos Islands, which is my goal trip. I hope anybody wants to take me to the Galapagos Islands.
Oh, you can't. The aquarium can't just send you there?
That would be lovely. That's a job I want. But yeah, so that's, but the Penguin Conservation Program is very interesting. There's so much we can learn in with working with the animals in the aquarium that can really help to tell us about the health of the oceans and how to properly care for its animals.
Now, what do you have a, why are the seals coming? What makes them sick or injured?
Sure.
You know, you only have about 2 minutes, so
okay.
we'll just have to wrap up.
Sure, absolutely. We see a lot of pups. So seals obviously depend on their mothers for, it's a fairly short period of time, only up to a couple of weeks. Mm-hmm. But if they get separated from their mothers before they really learn how to take care of themselves,
okay.
we see a lot of very newborn pups that come in.
And so those, that would be obvious to me then. If I see a pup by itself,
yes.
then I know this
yes.
pup is probably in trouble.
Yes,
and
absolutely.
I would call.
Yeah, we get them even still with the little umbilical cords attached, which means there's only days old.
Oh,
yeah.
Do you know how many babies they have?
Right now we have 11. We have 11 that we're caring for right now. They have one at a time. But
they have one
yeah.
at a time. Oh, the mother
right
must
now
be
we
so
have 11.
Sad. Like if you don't know where the mother is. And
yes, I mean, but they typically, it's not like you keep a child for 18 years. They typically spend a couple of weeks with them.
And that's
so,
it.
And that's all they need to be able to be up to weight and be able to care for themselves.
Oh.
But sometimes they need us to help and we're happy to step in and do that. Yes, they do feeding something like every 3 hours. So they have a team that works round the clock with the animals.
Oh, that's so interesting.
It's a lot of care and dedication that goes into running the aquarium, that's
well,
for sure.
Thank you so much for coming. It was
Absolutely.
Great
it was
having
nice to
you,
meet you,
and
too.
I can't wait to come and look at that fish wall you told me.
Well, definitely come by.
Okay. Thank you so much for joining us on the Lisa Saunders Show. See you next week.